Have you ever wondered what happens after Ever After? Have you always yearned to know if the end is really the end? No? Well, you're gonna find out anyway. With your hosts, Andi, Tami, and Gina. This is 2D Vision.
Hello everyone, welcome once again to 2D Vision Disney Sequels Explained. I'm your host, Gina, and as always, I'm joined by my two beautiful, special co-host Andi and Tami. How are you guys? How do you feel today?
Hello everyone. I don't know if I will ruin the illusion or something because we will upload this episode later, but happy Halloween.
Yeah, we're recording this on October 31st. Hi Tami, how are you?
Hi, I'm doing great. And speaking of Halloween, it was Halloween at my work, and as I was telling you guys, I had a sorcerer Mickey and a hippo from Fantasia at my work. And it was awesome. I got a picture with Sorcerer Mickey. And the hippo from Fantasia danced around with the little, they had a little crocodile stuffed toy. It was awesome. I was Minnie Mouse, and it was incredible.
Yeah, we saw the pictures, and like, yep. The girl that dressed up as the hippopotamus, like, she nailed Halloween. Like,
and apparently, she did Halloween. Like, when I saw her, I burst out laughing, and I had a big smile, and I'm like, I'm going to stand by you for the rest of the day. And yeah, apparently she did. Apparently she did 20 years of ballet, and her like hippo dance was amazing.
Oh, that makes so much sense. I really want to see a video of that. But it was perfect.
I will get the video.
Yes, please do. It's perfect timing because guess what? We're talking about Fantasia today.
Woohoo!
Talk about meant to be.
Yeah, Fantasia 2000, but also about.
Yeah, well, okay. So let's just jump right in. Okay. Fantasia 2000 is a sequel to the original Fantasia that was released in 1940, and Fantasia 2000 was actually released in 1999. Yep. Not really the 2000.
Well, but
yeah. Technicalities. And there's actually like a real debate, I guess, on whether to consider this actually a sequel. Mm-hmm. Because, I don't know, I guess it depends on what your definition of a sequel is, but at least in my head, I do count it as a sequel. And I guess we all do because we're talking about it in this Disney Sequels podcast. Yeah. But, I don't know why it shouldn't be. Like, it's a continuation of the first one. And, yeah, like, Fantasia is a unique thing. So, it's really hard to put it in a category and just think of it as any other movie. But if you go by the definition of it being the continuation of a first original movie, then yeah, Fantasia 2000 is completely a sequel in my eyes.
Yeah, Fantasia 2000 is not a traditional sequel, but Fantasia isn't a traditional movie.
Yeah.
I couldn't put it better. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you guys want to tell us a little bit about your experiences with the movie and what your memories of it are, the original 1941?
I can start because that'll be quick. I have no memories. I did not watch this movie. This is my first time watching Fantasia, and I'm so glad we started this podcast because it is such an amazing film, and I loved it. Like, I just found it super incredible, and the first thought is, like, every kid should see this because it would be a great way to introduce them to classical music. Like, because once kids can associate something with something good in their childhood, it sticks with them. It's something that they love for a long time. And if kids can fall in love with classical music because of movies like Fantasia and Fantasia 2000, that would be incredible. And yeah, those are my thoughts on it when I first saw it.
I'll jump right in because I don't think I ever saw this as a child. I don't know why. Like, for the longest time, I thought that I did. But I think I just watched, like, The Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is, like, the most famous bit of it. Mm-hmm. And that was it, because I was watching it for the podcast and I realized that I had never actually seen the movie, mm-hmm. like a movie. You know, I had seen The Sorcerer's Apprentice and I had seen the Nutcracker suit. And that's all I remember from it. Mm-hmm. And I don't even remember when I watched those. But yeah, I definitely think that I'm right with you there, Tami, because I do think that children should be encouraged to watch this movie.
Yes.
Because it's so special. I can't think of any other movie that's like this, like on this scale and produced by Disney. Like, it's such a unique piece of cinema, and I just love and appreciate it so much. it's like,
just,
right now.
It's like two different kinds of artists working together. And I find that incredible, because an animator, a drawer, like someone who draws, is way different from someone who composes music. And to see these two art forms work together to make something unified and just solid and real, like to make one beautiful thing out of these two brilliant mediums, is really incredible to watch.
Yeah, completely. And I just love the way that it starts with this like kind of abstract animated short, and the conductor it says something like, this is what the animators picture when they listen to this music. And I love that, because whenever I've been to like orchestra presentations or something, like I always listen to the music and imagine these abstract lights and colors and just whatever the music brings to my mind. And that was literally like what they did for this movie, for that short especially. And I just love that. I love the process of making this movie, of coming up with it. I love how Walt like envisioned it and made it happen. It's just a treasure. I think it's fantastic. Oh, yes. No pun intended.
Oh my gosh.
And I really wish pun I had intended. Seen it as a child.
That could be a review. Fantasia 2000 is fantastic.
Oh yeah. Spoilers.
I mean, if that's what you think.
I'm gonna think about that. But I definitely wish I would have seen this as a child. I think I would have appreciated it. And I don't know, maybe my parents just didn't think I'd be interested. Or maybe they weren't interested, so they never bought the VHS for me. I don't know. But at least now I have watched it. And I just think everyone should. So, Andi, you go, because you haven't spoken.
Yeah. Well, I'm smiling the whole time while you're saying that. Because, yeah, Fantasia is really, really amazing. And I hadn't watched it in a long time, but I did watch it as a kid. And I used to think, oh, I was a really weird kid because I really liked Fantasia, both Fantasias. But actually watching the movie now, maybe it wasn't such a stretch that I liked it, you know, because it's actually really entertaining. There are some parts in which your mind really, like, wanders off, or maybe things are a little slow.
Yeah, I think the last bit falls into that category. We were watching this at night, and after Bald Mountain, like that very energetic and like big short happens, and then this really slow pace
with Ave Maria.
The Ave Maria short starts, and it's just very soothing. I didn't fall asleep because I thought it was boring. I was falling asleep because it was just so very soothing. It was very slow and very like with a lot of ambience, I guess. It's beautiful.
Can we just mention how, like, in that, was it the Bald Mountain thing, how Deems Taylor, the host, just casually mentions that that's where Satan's worshiping
gathered?
Can we just Satan. I mean, it was the 40s, I guess. They were a little bit more blunt.
I guess that was the only time Disney ever said the word Satan in a movie until Wreck-It Ralph.
I don't know, I think...
it's Satan. I think
Hunchback said devil.
Yeah, devil.
But not Satan.
It's not Satan.
It's really not the same, but I appreciate the casual mention of Satan.
Satan.
And not just Satan, and his worshippers.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay, we're acknowledging this.
Yeah.
Casual Satanism right there.
Yeah, actually, what you were saying, at that short, it's so energetic, and it just freaks you out in the best way. And then it's like big exercise for your mind and for your soul and for your heart. And then they leave you to Ave Maria, and it's like, of course you're going to fall asleep, you're tired.
Yeah,
it's like a yoga class when at the end they just let you to relax and almost sleep. That's Fantasia.
That's amazing.
I also love how they mentioned that before the Nutcracker short, they say something like, "Oh, this piece of music is not performed anymore," and like you just see how dated a little bit this movie is, because of course everyone performs the Nutcracker.
The Nutcracker everywhere is going to.
Yeah, but I guess right at that time the Nutcracker wasn't as popular, and not a lot of people knew it, and there weren't any performances of it, I guess. And I just found that very funny, because the conductor is something like, oh, I guess you won't recognize this song, like,
Yeah, I hear it every Christmas. What you're talking about?
Like, well, this was before Barbie and the Nutcracker, when the Nutcracker made its renaissance. So it makes sense.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Okay. Can I finish?
Andi, I have a question.
Yes.
How do you feel about Iris showing up in the Pastoral Symphony?
Oh, okay. You say it because I like Iris.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, Iris is my favorite Greek goddess, and I love seeing Iris love in Fantasia. Thank you very much, animators.
She's gorgeous. She's gorgeous.
She's actually like one of the most ethereal and realistic figures in that whole short.
Continue.
Yeah, to finish my thoughts. Yes, I actually I watched it a lot as a kid, and I also watch a lot of Fantasia 2000. I don't know if we're going to start talking about our memories with Fantasia 2000 or not.
I just wanted to mention, like, just how emblematic this movie is, and like it was so groundbreaking. Like, Walt's intention literally was to make it like he wanted to emulate the experience of going to see an orchestra, and they developed this whole complete new sound system for the theaters.
Yep.
And it was really groundbreaking. Like, it was, how do you say, I can't find the word right now, but it really looked to the future, and it gave animation, like, new room to grow from. I don't know how to word it, but it was just, I think it deserves more recognition than it does, even though it is a classic. But I guess it was a very expensive movie to make, I hear, especially with this development of the sound system, because Walt really wanted it to feel like you were watching live musicians. So it was very costly, and it did make its money back eventually, and especially with home release. But I guess at the time, it felt like they worked too hard and spent too much money, and they did make the money back, but not as much as, like, is it worth it? So, yeah. And, like, also, I love, I just love the Sorcerer's Apprentice short, and so it's my favorite.
Where Mickey straight up murders a broom, like,
We can talk about that when we talk about the Sorcerer's Apprentice, because it also makes an appearance on
Fantasia 2000, but I just wanted to mention that, and how the wizard that appears is called Yensith, and everyone knows the story behind that, and how, like, any Disney fan wants, if they want to show off, they're gonna throw that fact at you. But, like, it's just such a well-known fact, like, at this point everyone knows that Yensith is just Disney backwards, and he was inspired by Walt. And but I just find that really funny, and whenever I watch it, I just think of that. Okay, so
I wanted to say something. Did you know Yensith is Disney backwards?
Okay. Oh my god.
Oh my god. I did not know that. That is brand new information.
Okay. Fantasia 2000?
Yeah, so let's jump right into Fantasia 2000, and let's just start with also our memories. I know that's going to be very short as well. So, Tami, do you have any memories of Fantasia 2000?
No.
your memories go
so there's one thing. It's not really a memory, but so I used to be obsessed with this Aladdin commentary. It was like an hour and a half documentary about the making of the Aladdin movie. And there was a good part of it with an animator called Eric Goldberg. He's the man that designed the genie, and he also was a main artistic director on Fantasia 2000, and he would talk about how the genie was inspired by Al Hirschfeld. The thick and thick lines, the designs of his cartoon work, that really inspired him. That not just the genie, actually, just the whole artistic direction of Aladdin. The thick and thick lines of Aladdin that make it, and the curvature of all the designs really were influenced by Al Hirschfeld. And you can actually see that in Rhapsody Blue. Like, it's a very curvy design for all the people and all the everything in the short. And he was really inspired by Al Hirschfeld, and he would talk about how he was a hero of his, and how he was a big influence on Aladdin, and then that he was very thankful that he got to work with him again in Fantasia for Rhapsody in Blue. So I was really excited to watch that because I've watched that documentary like 100 times since I was 16. And it was just really nice to see. And Rhapsody in Blue is one of my favorite shorts. And I'll talk about that later. But yeah.
That makes a lot of sense, actually. Yeah.
That's more of a memory than I have, like, of this movie, like, at all. Like, if I did never watched Fantasia, I think I could have never watched Fantasia 2000. Yeah. I think the only memory I actually do have is, like, sometime I was watching the Disney Channel. Like, I was zapping through channels, and I wound up at Disney Channel when they were playing Fantasia 2000, but it was at the Pomp and Circumstance short. That's basically the second-to-last short with Donald. And I watched it from there, but, like, that was all I ever watched, the Donald short and the final, the Firebird short. But I wasn't really actually paying attention. Like, I was just, it was something that I had put on the background. So, like, this was actually my first time watching it. And, yeah, I'll talk about my feelings about the movie, like, in a little bit. But, yeah, it was a fantastic experience. And there I go with the word fantastic again. I was trying to use it on purpose. It's just or maybe. I like to use. Maybe in my subconscious.
Oh, my God.
Fantasia. Fantasia. So, yeah, I think it's a deserving continuation of Fantasia. Yeah. And that's my general thoughts on it. I'm going to continue to Andi.
Okay. As I said, I watched this movie as a kid. I don't think I watched it as much as others, but I do remember when I was going to my grandma's house, to my grandma's from my father's side. Yeah. She only had about 3 VHS that she only owned 3 VHSs. So it was a goofy movie. It was Fantasia 2000 and it was Home Alone. And I don't know, for some reason, neither of the cousins wanted a live action movie, so we always watched one of those two. And I think that's the reason I watched it as a kid. And But when I had my resurgence on the Disney movies, I remember very clearly I owned this DVD because in one of the Secret Santas on my classroom on middle school, I asked for the Fantasia 2000 DVD and the Princess and the Frog DVD.
Amazing.
Yeah, because I don't know, I think it was like in a special edition or something. No, wait, I think. I don't remember.
It was like the 10th anniversary, so like if it was at the same time of Prince and the Frog, that was around 2009. So no, but it should have been the 10th anniversary.
But Princess and the Frog was released in theaters in 2009, I think. So maybe it was like a year after that. But yeah, maybe the edition was like, that. Yeah. But I actually that DVD has I don't know if it's the same in English, Destino, or is it Destino?
Oh yeah, Destino,
from
I think.
Destino. From Dali, and that's how I watched that short. And yeah, I just have a lot of memories with this, and when we were watching it, I was like, oh, I remember this short, and aww, I remember that one, and I remember this one, and I was like, oh, this one is good, but this one is also so very good. And I just love every single short in both Fantasia movies. I love them so much, including the first one in Fantasia, the original Fantasia, even though it's kind of boring for some people, I liked it. And
I think it's a nice introduction. Like, yeah.
So I said on the first episode, on the introductory episode, that this was my favorite Disney sequel, and I stand by it. And I think it's actually one of my favorite Disney movies as well.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Like the Fantasia in general. Oh, like, yeah. The Fantasia saga, it's my favorite. It's one of my favorite movies.
Amazing.
I love it too.
Okay, so let's jump right into our thoughts on what we liked about the movie, and we're gonna go. I think we're gonna go sequence by sequence, right? We should do that.
Like how we did for Belle's Magical Christmas World.
The other masterpiece.
Same format.
Okay, so if anyone out there listening to this podcast has never watched Fantasia or Fantasia 2000, I'm just gonna go a quick run through of what this is. It's basically a collection of shorts, of animated shorts, set to different pieces of classical music, and that's the gist of it. That's basically all of it, and then each short has its story and its moral and its style, and I think different, I don't know. Yeah, it's. I mean, what I was saying about it being groundbreaking, it's also because for Disney, it's not usual to see all this different variety of animation.
Mm-hmm.
Like mainly they have a very specific style for each era of their studio, and this is a nice way of showcasing different styles of animation. Like Disney animators are so talented, and they deserve like this window to express themselves in a more, I guess, liberal way. I read on the Fantasia IMDb trivia that Walt basically gave them like a lot of freedom with it, and they got to choose all the colors, the color palette of each short. Like Walt didn't intervene on their creative decisions, and I think that's fantastic. Again with the fantastic. Okay, yes, I'm gonna let it flow. So yeah, I think that was that's why Fantasia like is really important.
Mm-hmm.
And what I was getting to with this, I had a point.
Yeah, I'm sure you had.
Oh. I'm sure I did. I got lost somewhere along the way.
Awesome.
You were explaining.
Oh yeah, I was just explaining, and I was actually wanted to share like this bit of trivia that I just read, that Jeffrey Katzenberg was opposed to this movie. Like he didn't want it to get made for some reason. I don't know because
Jeffrey Katzenberg.
Yeah, it's just Katzenberg.
He wanted to take part of your world out of The Little Mermaid.
Don't remind me.
He took like 10 minutes out of The Black Cauldron. And
yeah, he edited the Black Cauldron by himself because he just wasn't happy with what they were doing, and he just took the film and just edited it himself. And he's a very strange man. Anyway, what I was getting to is that he was opposed to this movie getting made, but the animators wanted to make it anyway, so they started making it behind his back.
And I think, I love it. Amazing.
I just love that piece of information, and I just love to imagine the animators working on it and Jeffrey Katzenberg suddenly appearing on their offices and be like, "What are you doing?" "Nothing, sir. I'm working on Kingdom of the Sun. What do I look like I'm doing?" Yeah, I love that. Someone should make a movie about that.
Actually,
the Rebel Alliance of the Disney animators.
Oh, yeah. Wasn't there like a drawing that one of the animators made that it's Jeffrey Katzenberg in a devil's costume or something?
Yeah, they did.
It's an archive. It's real.
You should watch Waking Sleeping Beauty. It's a documentary.
I love it. I love that documentary.
It's in there. Oh my gosh, it's part of the B-roll. It's just like 1 second.
Yeah, you should, because it's there and it's really hilarious. And yeah. I don't know, Jeffrey Katzenberg is a controversial figure and we shouldn't have a debate on him right now.
Right now, we're talking
about stating the facts. He didn't want this movie to get made, but thank God the animators, like, pulled through and they decided they were not gonna hear it from their own chairman and went through with the project anyway. And thank God for that, because, yeah. Okay, so let's jump right into it. I love this movie. I think it's fantastic again. I loved every second of it ever since it started and until it ended, and I just was longing for more, because I think this movie is not long enough. Like Fantasia is the only Disney movie that's 2 hours long, and Fantasia 2000 is just like 77 minutes long, and like it ended and I was like, but I want more.
It is actually a pretty short film.
Like it's like the length of a direct to home video movie, and I don't know why it's so short. I definitely think that they should have added more shorts, because I just keep longing for more.
Yeah. With Destino, it's a little bit longer, but not the original cut.
But Destino was supposed to be like Fantasia 2006. That was the original plan.
Yeah.
But once Fantasia 2006 was scrapped, like they released the shorts individually, the shorts that they had already made. And yeah, so that wasn't supposed to be in Fantasia, like, anyway, so it was still gonna be short.
Maybe it will be in Fantasia 24.
we were theorizing, Andi and I, that when they will make the next Fantasia and like 2040, because it will be the 100th anniversary of Fantasia, and like I think it would be a fantastic opportunity, and they could showcase the new the new developments of animation and just how it has developed since like 1940. Oh. And I think it would be perfect. And yeah. I don't know if someone at Disney is thinking about it right now, but they definitely should. And if 2040 gets here and we don't get a new Fantasia, I'm gonna riot.
let's go and take
do it.
Disney Animation Studios will be the next chairman.
Yeah. So let's go short by short, shall we?
Shall we? Okay. Yes, we shall.
So the first short in this movie is called Symphony No. 5, of course. It's based on Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. And it's basically a direct throwback to the original Fantasia opening because it's all abstract and it's patterns and lights and colors. Yeah, so that's basically it. It's just a very short about nothing in particular. Just the Wikipedia page says that it's supposed to be like a battle of light and dark. And I definitely see that. I definitely see what they mean by that. Because it's definitely like showcasing lights. And the animation of light in this short is
amazing.
It's absolutely outstanding. Like, I'm watching it right now and it's like, and the way that it goes with the music. Like, the Fifth Symphony of Beethoven is like one of my favorite pieces of music ever. Because, I don't know, I just find it catchy and I find it like,
dramatic,
and that's me. And I just love the colors and the patterns that they chose for the short. I think it's just really fun to watch,
like all those yellows and blues and pinks. It's just really the sky.
Yeah, and you can watch this and watch the original Fantasia, like original opening short, and you can see, like, you can actually see and basically like almost feel the difference in animation that 50 something years have, and it's just fantastic to watch. I love the short so much. What do you guys think?
No, you're right, like you're saying that. I'm just thinking about the difference in animation and my heart is racing. Fantasia was groundbreaking, and then again, Fantasia 2000 is showcasing all these new technologies and new forms of animation. And yes, this is the kind of animation Disney was doing in the beginning of the 2000s, late 90s, and it feels like it. But it's also very experimental and it has a lot of geometric shapes. Like, it has these butterflies. This butterfly thing is that it's just like two triangles. And it's telling a story with just those shapes and the music and the colors, and wow, just...
Yeah, just the level of creativity that has to go through to pull this off. I can't even begin to imagine, like, sitting at a table with a pencil in my hand and trying to come up with something to put to classical music like this, and I'm just baffled. I'm just amazed at the talent. Yeah, so what do you think, Tami?
I just, like you said, I'm amazed how the animation fits perfectly with the music. Like, everything is just in time and is paced well. And what I was thinking when I was watching this is, I don't know if it's accurate. I don't know if I have a misinformed view of what this disorder is, but synesthesia. Do you know what I'm talking about? When you're stimulated by music, sometimes people see colors and shapes. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I thought, like, with every strong beat, there was like an explosion or like something popped up, and with the soothing beats, that's when the soothing music came on, that's when the butterflies are flying around in the clouds, and it's just everything was absolutely perfect and fit the music amazingly. And like you said, I can't imagine being an artist and listening to the music and creating these scenes that were inspired by this music. It takes an intense amount of creativity, and it's really, really wonderful to start off this film.
Yes, you're totally right. It's like we said, it's the opening number from the original Fantasia, but plus 2000. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's just a fantastic opening. Like, it just gets you right in the mood to watch a bunch of animation and just to enjoy that. And I think it's a perfect mood setting. That's how I would qualify this short.
Like in the original Fantasia, the first short, it was really soothing. It just kind of put you to sleep.
kind of. If you're tired, you're definitely going to sleep.
Yeah, a little bit.
But yeah, I think definitely this one has a little bit more energy and
No, that's something that I loved about Fantasia 2000 that I, like, I don't want to say I found Fantasia boring. Like, it's not. It's a great film. But, like you said, I watched this when I was, like, late at night after work and I was tired and I was dozing off a little bit. It's very soothing. It's very mellow. And Fantasia 2000 really had all that energy and really kept me invested in its shorts.
And that's also
what I appreciated about the difference. And maybe that's also a difference in time. You know, the style of... the entertainment of the time.
Yeah, and the audience was different. Yeah,
you're totally right. You're totally, totally right. You're spot on.
What was entertaining for the people in the 40s is not as entertaining for the people of the 90s. So they had to adapt to that, and they did perfectly, I think.
Well, like we said, Fantasia, it was really groundbreaking. And it's a really, really important piece of history. And I said it was entertaining for me. But the pieces in Fantasia 2000 had a quicker rhythm, like a fast rhythm, and just because of the time that it was made, it's not just gratuitous.
And it also fits like Walt's vision of what Fantasia could be, like just this platform for showing how animation has developed and everything that you can achieve with animation. And that's why I think they can and they should keep making Fantasia movies every so often, because technology advances. Like, if they made a Fantasia today, like, it would be so different from the ones we've had.
Gosh, it would be all CGI.
Yeah. It would all be CGI.
Or, like, the Paperman animation or something like that.
Like, imagine all they could do. That would, like, be imagine, beautiful. I can imagine that, like, them developing some kind of 4D system for the Fantasia. Like, I don't know. Like we said, 2040, like, so you can go watch it and just have a complete different experience, like a unique experience, and that's what Walt wanted Fantasia to be, and that's what Fantasia 2000 keeps doing, I think, and that's why I think it's such a deserving sequel. So you guys want to move on to the next short?
Yes, okay.
So this one, I have the softest spot for this one.
Yeah.
The next short is Pines of Rome by Ottorino Respighi. I hope I am pronouncing that correctly. Sounds Italian.
I guess.
And it's about a group of whales, a family of whales, and the youngest one gets lost from its parents and gets trapped in an iceberg and has to break through to get back to them. And it's just a fantastic little short about whales flying in space.
Yeah,
and if you would tell me that without any context, I would be like, "What? Did you just smoke?"
I love it.
But
can I just ask? Did anyone roll their eyes when Steve Martin came up?
Why?
No.
Oh, like, no. I think what happened with him?
I just thought it was so out of place. I feel like it took me out of the film.
Really?
A little bit. I'm just gonna say, because I don't think Steve Martin is as relevant as he was maybe when this movie came out. Like, maybe they thought, like, I don't know why they didn't get, like, Robin Williams. I think he would have made a more...
That is so, huge. Like, I thought they should have, like, had Disney legends. Like, they had, I don't know.
James Earl Jones?
Yeah, like, Angela, you know, James Earl Jones, Angela Lansbury. You could have had Robin Williams. That would have meant so much more than having Steve Martin. Or even those two magicians. I don't remember their names. And Bette Midler. I didn't understand those choices.
Yeah, me neither. Like, I don't know why they chose Steve Martin particularly, and I don't know if it took me out of the movie, but I do think it doesn't hold up as well as they intended back then. Like, looking back, I don't think they would have picked him if they had known. I think they would have gone with someone, like we said, as Robin Williams, someone who was more timeless.
Did something happen with Steve Martin that I don't know?
Relevant.
Oh, okay.
I just didn't think he was an appropriate choice as a host for this film.
I think it's just a random choice.
Took me out.
Yeah. Okay, so... But
yeah, that was it. Okay, continue.
So, yeah, Pines of Rome. I think in theory, like, the idea for the short is kind of weird and, like... I would have the hardest time in picturing it, but once you see it on film, you're like, yes, yes, like you're sold, you're absolutely sold on it. So what do you guys think about this?
I, like you said, I do have the softest spot for this one because it's about a little whale, a little flying whale, and I love whales. And it's just, this. I think this short has everything because it starts, okay, you're introduced to the family, and then the baby gets lost, and then you just stay with the baby, just wondering how will he get out. Then well, you have the music to accompany it with, and you're just feeling all these things, and you're just worried for the little whale, and then I don't know, it becomes like this whole thing with a lot of other whales, and they start flying onto the sky, and beams of light appear, and the music just rushes in, and it's just wow. And also the animation, it's really particular, it's unusual, and I don't know if it's the technology that they used, or because I don't think I've seen something quite like this since this has come out. Like mm-hmm. The eyes move a little differently from the skin, and but the sky, it's like more traditional, but it's CGI, but it's also 2D. It I don't know.
It's really remarkable.
Yeah, I like I said, I don't remember anything that looks like this. And the ending is just awesome as well.
I did read that, well, all the whales are CGI. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's obvious. If you see it, like, you can just tell. But I read on the IMDb that the eyes are 2D animated.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they made that decision because they were trying to get the whales to have the CGI eyes, but they didn't have the technology to make the eyes as expressive as they wanted it to be. So they decided to just have the whales CGI and animate separately the eyes in 2D. I think that makes for a very particular, as Andi says, look. And I just really appreciate it so much. And I don't know, I guess the CGI, of course, looks a little bit, just a tiny bit dated because, you know, we just saw Moana, like, almost 2 years ago, and, like, you just see the look of the ocean, of the water, of the creatures there, and it looks just so much smoother, of course, but it still holds up amazingly well, and I think what I like most about the short is just how creative it is, like, They could have made it just with whales on water.
Yeah.
So just swimming around in water. Mm-hmm. But they didn't just... They weren't going to settle with that. They pictured the whales flying. And
whales but times 2,000.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is the motto for this movie. Like, make everything plus 2,000. 2,000.
Like, yeah. Like, I just really love that. I love the image of flying whales and
the clouds,
and using the clouds as if it was the sea, and I just kept gasping throughout the whole short. I kept gasping because I was just amazed at everything, like when they're underwater, the way the light plays, the way the light plays with the shapes of the whales, and how it creates shadows, and just how it perfectly emulates the feeling of being underwater. And then when they get out and start floating, and they eventually get through the clouds, and they just start splashing around in the clouds, it's a fantastic image, and it's iconic, and I don't think that I have ever seen something like that, and there's a reason why most of the marketing for this movie, I think, is this short.
Yeah.
Especially that shot of the whales jumping from the clouds at the end, and because it's just iconic, and it's a beautiful... It's just beautiful to look at. I have no other words to describe it. I think it's just, it's beautiful. It's art animated. This is what animation is. Like, you
it's
know?
Art.
It's art.
Okay.
So what do you think, Tami?
Okay, so I love this short because whales are one of my favorite animals. I just love how they're gentle giants. And I think they're so adorable, and I love them. and I love stars. I love stars. I think they're gorgeous. I love looking up the sky and when I see a ton of stars. And just seeing them in that end shot, like, flying throughout the stars, it's absolutely gorgeous, and it's one of my favorite things ever. I think it's just absolutely breathtaking. And as I was watching this film, like, I'm looking at it again, and I don't know, like, correct me if I'm off, but you know how we were talking about how this is a marriage between two different mediums of art, music and drawing. And yes. I was looking at it, like, the way that they thought that this could be a marriage between two interrelated things, like flying and swimming. So the way they fly through the sky is like they're swimming through the ocean. Yeah. And it's like a marriage between those two elements. And they're very different, but you can also see a gracefulness that coincides between both those two different parts of the world. And I think they just found that connection and went for it. And it turned into this beautiful masterpiece.
That is really poetic. Can I just say they also married CGI into the animation?
Yeah, they did. There you go. Well.
Yes. So many marriages in this short. It's just wonderful.
I could watch it over and over again and not get bored. Yes. Like, if I had seen this as a child, I think this would have been one of those scenes that I just kept rewinding because I was that kind of child that...
We know.
Yeah. I can tell you how many times I used to rewind my favorite scenes in movies. Like, it was annoying. Like, my cousins constantly were, like, going to my mom and telling them that Gina is not letting us watch the movie because she just wants to keep repeating the same scenes. Mm-hmm. And this would be one of those scenes that I would just keep repeating and forcing my cousins to watch again and again because I just can't get enough of it.
Can I just say the host, Steve Martin, I guess? I didn't remember it was him. But when he is presenting the short, he's saying, when you hear the title Pines of Rome, you imagine, okay, so the music, you accompany it with images of Rome and of cities and of people. But when the animators listened to the music, they thought about flying whales. And I don't know why that line stuck with me until today. I just always remember that line. I don't know why. Maybe... I don't know. I have no idea.
It just showcases how different the background animator is. You don't have to explain it.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, I love that.
I don't know. Next short.
Do you want to go to the next one?
Yeah, I think Tami has a lot to say about this.
This has such a special history and special, like, I don't know what to call it.
This was my second favorite short when I was a kid.
I love this short. I love this short. It's amazing.
Okay, let me introduce it. Okay, so this one is introduced by Quincy Jones. And it's called Rhapsody in Blue by George Gershwin. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. I'm sorry if I'm not. And it's a short set in New York City in the 1930s, and it's designed after as Tami said, the style of drawing of Al Hirschfeld. Is that correct?
Yeah, Al Hirschfeld.
Hirschfeld. Sorry. And it's basically a short about a bunch of different people in New York that. Each of them has a different, like, dream and, I guess, struggle. Goal and different struggle, and all their stories end up colliding without them knowing, and at the end, they basically, everyone gets what they wanted, and it's a very, just a special little short, and do any of you guys want to start?
Tami, you want to take this one?
Yeah, I can start. Well, like I said, it was a collaboration between Al Hirschfeld and Eric Goldberg, and I think actually his wife worked on it too. I could be wrong. I think that's
Eric's
what I heard in the documentary.
Or else?
Eric's wife.
Eric and his wife were really involved in this.
Yeah, but as I was preparing to watch this film, I remembered that I had this memory of Eric Goldberg idolizing Al Hirschfeld and getting to work with him, and so I did a bit of research, and I was, um, I I found out that, well, it's just like a funny little tidbit. So Al Hirschfeld, Eric Goldberg was a big fan of Al Hirschfeld when he was a little kid. And his parents introduced him to his cartoons, and he was hooked ever since. And it may have influenced his art style even. And so you can imagine how old Al Hirschfeld was when Eric Goldberg himself became an animator. He was pretty old. So when he was on the set of, when he was working on Aladdin, he called him up saying, "You're a big influence. I was wondering if you would like to, if you would like to visit the set. I'm working for Disney. We have this film. You're a big influence. Do you want to see our work?" And Al Hirschfeld told Eric Goldberg was that, "I would love to, but I have like 3 deadlines due on Monday and I need to finish my work. But thank you for the offer." And the first thing that Eric Goldberg thinks is that this dude is 87 and still has 3 deadlines. That's how you can tell how he loved his work. You know, he just kept doing it until like he couldn't do it anymore. Like he kept going until his late 80s even. And I'm glad that they finally got to meet and they finally got to work together on this wonderful short. They got to collaborate, and like it's a love letter to New York City. And I think New York City is a wonderful, wonderful place. And I went there in the summer and it's absolutely gorgeous. It's nothing like I've ever seen before. The skyscrapers are honestly, they look like they reach the sky, and it's super busy. It's super lively. And I think they portrayed the busyness and the liveliness of New York City in this short. And one thing that really stands out to me is the colors and how this really shows how colors can tell a story and how it can tell and how it can show character. I really like how they had like the little girl have like a really vibrant purple. It shows like her youth, her energy. And I like how and then there's that older woman who has like a more muted purple. Like it shows her age. It shows how she's a bit not as young, not as lively as the little girl. Like it's the same color, but like the difference in shades can really tells you about their character and who they are. And I just think they did amazingly with that, and it's a beautiful short.
Andy? You said everything. You said everything.
I'm so
right.
Sorry. I'm so sorry. No, I love
no,
it.
No, I meant it as a compliment. Like you did well.
Great.
Like you said. For example, I don't know, there's a man that is the man that is searching for a job, and all his colors
his
are really
is
muted.
Joe, by the way.
Oh my god, they have names.
Yeah,
what are their names?
Everyone has a name. Like every main character of this short has a name. I think the little girl is called Rachel.
Oh.
Constructor worker is Duke. Mm-hmm. He's named after a famous jazz player, accordingly.
Nice.
And the jobless person is called Jobless Joe. And I think the guy that is married to this very uptight woman is called John, I think. I don't remember. I read it on IMDb, but the one that really stuck to me was Jobless Joe, because it was just really funny. And I think it was mentioned that he's the only one that's not named after anyone in particular.
Okay.
Poor Jobless Joe. But
why was the little girl named Rachel?
Because the daughter of Eric and his wife.
Okay. Aww. Yeah. Things that I can say about this short, I haven't seen this type of animation done by Disney ever again after this short. I don't know if there's something I'm missing, but I don't think I've seen that. And I really like it. Like you said, it's inspired on this artist, and it just the whole short feels really inspired, and it feels like all the people working on it were just really giving their all on it and really liking the product. I don't know how long was it in production, but this short is 12 minutes long. 12 minutes animated short, and it has just a lot of detail. And that is something you can applaud to. And also this music they chose is one of my favorite pieces of music ever. And I have a little piece of trivia that nobody will ever I don't know if somebody ever noticed this, But I don't remember in what Stuart Little movie was it that one part of this music was playing on the background when the cat is talking to the other cat. And and I remember I noticed this when I was a kid and was like, oh my god, it's the music from Fantasia 2000. Wow. And like, whenever I hear this music, it's like, oh my god, it's too little. Before I think about Fantasia 2000.
Wow.
Yeah. it's just really, really fun. It just never stops. This has all sorts of detail, and each frame has, I don't know, their own thing. Everything is happening all the time. Mm-hmm. And I really like it. And I really like that it's all interconnected stories about people that don't know each other.
Yeah.
And I'm a sucker mm-hmm. for those kinds of stories. So, Gina?
I'm just right there with you guys on praising this short. I think it's fantastic. I absolutely love the rhythm of it.
Yeah,
it's so alive. Like, it's a very jazzy sort of music. Yes. And rhythm. Mm-hmm. And I just love that. I think it's it's the perfect music to set this short to. Mm-hmm. I just love how everything just feels so alive. And you know, as we have mentioned in the past, we, Andy and I, are film students. Mm-hmm. And I just have to applaud how this short, in such a short time, with no dialogue, it gets you to feel for these characters. Mm-hmm. In just brief moments. And you absolutely feel for them. And sometimes it's very cheap for you as a filmmaker to just grant your character's wishes at the end. Like, sometimes if you don't handle it correctly, it can just feel forced. It can feel not deserved. And it can feel just lazy. Mm-hmm. But they actually go to the trouble of just showcasing the pain that the people go through in their daily lives because they don't have what they want, and you just feel for them and you desperately want them to get it. So by the end, when they do get it in this like fantastic big animated sequence, when everything gets connected in the end, it just feels cathartic, it feels deserved, it feels like this is what was meant to happen. Mm-hmm. And I just have to praise it to death because it does. It is 12 minutes long, and that's a very long time for an animated short.
Yeah.
But in perspective, it's not a long time to present 5-6 different characters, each with a different story, each with a different wish, each with a different goal,
mm-hmm.
and a different mm-hmm. you know, personality. And they do, and they do that, and they absolutely nail it. And I think this is a short that every filmmaker or aspiring filmmaker should watch.
Yeah.
Because it just shows the power of images, the power of showing and not telling. I don't need any words. Mm-hmm. I don't need any. Yeah, that. I don't need any words to understand these characters. And I think you can relate to every single one of them. Every single one of them.
Yeah.
I think everyone has one in particular that they can identify with, but you just mm-hmm. feel for everyone. And I just need to praise that. Mm-hmm. I think it's a fantastic little short. It's 12 minutes long, but it does not feel like that because it's masterful in its pacing. It's masterful in its style. I think it's just such a unique, because it was inspired by this artist, it's so unique. It's so different from everything in Fantasia 2000 and mm-hmm. in Disney as a whole. And
mm-hmm.
yeah, this is another one that I could watch over and over again and keep finding details, like, and just, maybe I can just put this and look for a specific part that I want to watch again, but end up watching it all
yeah.
again, because it's just so compelling to watch.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a fun short. Like, it's fun, it's emotional, it's artistic, it's everything. I cannot even begin, like, I don't know, I can't find words, like, for to describe this short.
Is it making you want to go to New York?
I'm the only one of you guys that has never been to New York. Tammy has, and Andy has. I have never been to New York.
I don't remember.
I would never want to live there, but I loved it.
I really want to go. I think it's one of my biggest goals in life, because I
a lot of Alexander Hamilton stuff in New York.
Stop it. Yeah. Well, you have a hoodie.
Hey, New York loves Hamilton.
Oh, yeah, I bet. And, yeah, just such a place. You keep hearing all amazing stories and about New York. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I think this short perfectly makes you want to at least visit it. But, yeah, mm-hmm. I also kind of feel like I will be disappointed if this song, Rhapsody in Blue, is not playing everywhere when I go to New York.
24/7.
Like, where's my jazzy vibes?
That's what iPhones are for.
Yeah. Like, where's Duke? Where's Rachel? Where's Jobless Joe?
Who is your favorite New Yorker, guys?
Oh, I think it's Duke.
Yeah.
The construction worker, I think. I just really love
him. I like Duke, too.
Like, I really
like that.
Yeah.
Go, sorry.
No, I just really like the how he has a job, but his true dream is becoming a jazz musician, mm-hmm. and then his job is eventually taken over by Jobless Joe.
Right.
Once he goes and actually like starts fulfilling his dream of becoming a jazz musician, he leaves his job, and then Jobless Joe comes and he just gets hired because they need someone, and I just love how that connects, like those two stories connect. Like, you don't know how your actions will impact another's life, and I think that's part of the message of this short. And yeah, I just love it, and I think Duke is my favorite. I think I don't know, I have a soft spot for musicians.
I think my favorite is the John, was his name, was
Jobless, no, the man who wants to be free of his wife. That's John. I think
I love him too. He's my favorite too. I love his character design, and all he wants is to just be happy. That's all he wants. All he just wants to get out. He wants to find himself. He wants to dance with what are they called? Cabaret dancers?
Yes.
He just wants to be free and live his life.
What do you call the thing that's like drawn in the ground that is like numbered and he starts jumping on it?
Hopscotch. Oh, yeah.
What?
Hopscotch.
Okay, No, of course, in Spanish it's a completely different word, but I just love
it. I think it's different in different cities.
In Mexico alone. Yeah. But I just love that he's playing on that, and his wife just turns to him, and he's like, oh, and he stops. And like, I've been John at that moment, like when I'm just trying to have fun and like be a little wild, and someone eventually has to be like, Gina, tone it down, Gina, what are you doing? And I'm like, oh, okay. And I just love, I really love him, because I think it's really, it's just a reminder of not letting your inner child die, even by, you know, real life and just everything that can be wrong in the real world. But, you know, if you have that childlike, you know, I guess innocence, but also like wonder and spirit, I think you can, like, you should have it, and you should not let people get you down for that. And I really like that. I really like how he expresses that.
Oh, very cute lessons on
that makes
me
love John even more.
Yeah.
To hold on to into my own life. Like, I can still be in a mature adult and do adult things and still, like, feel childlike and keep that within myself. Mm-hmm. And that's so much of why I want to be an elementary school teacher, because I appreciate children so much, and I want to help them keep that as they transition into middle school, into high school. I want them to be able to know it's okay to be childlike, to be themselves, because that's one of the best qualities they're ever going to have.
Yeah, I love that.
That's amazing.
I love everything that you can, like, we can dissect this short character by character, and like, it could feel its own podcast, I think. We're not gonna do that, but like, if you haven't seen the short, if you haven't seen Fantasia 2000, then definitely do. I think you have no idea what you're missing. It's stylish, and it's beautiful, and it's pretty, and it's emotional, and yeah.
Okay, we can go on to.
Yeah, we can move on to the next one. Oh, this is a very fun one. Thank you. it's Piano Concerto Number 2, and it's by Dmitri Shostakovich, and it's based on The Steadfast Tin Soldier by Hans Christian Andersen.
One of my favorite tales.
Yeah, it's fantastic, and I they mentioned this in the movie. It's introduced by Bette Midler. They mentioned how they had been trying to make this story, like Disney had been trying to portray this, and I think there even was plans to have the Steadfast Tin Soldier in the original Fantasia, but they could just not find the right music for it until they eventually found this piano concerto, and they just found it perfect for the story. Mm-hmm. And the big difference is that this actually has a happy ending, and the original does not. Do any of you guys want to start to talk about this?
I can do that. Okay. Yes. Well, then again, this is a kind of animation that I haven't seen anywhere else.
Just quick, interesting trivia. This is actually the first Disney non-Pixar animated thing ever to just be completely CGI.
Yeah, and actually these kinds of CGI make sense, and it helps because it's a ballerina and it's a little tin soldier, and they're, well, toys or something. I don't know what texture they were trying to go for, but yeah. And well, the little story about the short is, there's this little ballerina that is dancing, and it's like stalked by this, I don't know, Jack in the Box that is really, really creepy.
Really creepy.
I was just watching it. It was so uncomfortable. Yeah. And you have this, I don't know how you call it, this batch of tin soldiers.
Yeah, just a bunch of tin soldiers.
Yeah, a bunch of tin
soldiers.
Yeah, and one of them is missing a leg, and of course, this is our hero. And he falls in love with the ballerina, and the ballerina is actually just king to him. But then things happen. The Jack in the Box finds out, and he pushes the tin soldier out of the window, and then he comes down the sewers, and and things start to get very red as well of him, and things start escalating, and I didn't remember this short to be this exciting. But yeah, he almost dies like a bunch of times. But in somehow he for a variety of reasons that yours were conveniently there, he comes back to the house and comes back to the ballerina, and ultimately saves her from the Jack in the Box, and that is the happy ending. Mm-hmm. And yeah, Disney has this habit of making happy endings for Hans Christian Andersen's stories. And yeah, I really like the short. It's just really, really cute. I really like the character designs, and the animation really helps. It's kind of stuffy, and you see, okay, it's really from the 2000s, or, well, not 2000s, this is late 90s.
Late 90s.
Yes. But it also, I don't know if it's completely CGI, I don't know if it has, like, a 2D makeup or something, because...
It has, like, a painterly feel.
Yeah, yes. Yes. And, I don't know, the ballerina is really cute. And they are really cute. Also, one thing that's really adorable is that he goes to a ballerina because he thinks she's also missing one leg.
Yeah.
But actually, she's just in a pose, and in a ballet pose, and he's just
that.
And then
as soon as I saw that, I was like, oh, my heart ached for him.
Yeah.
Like, because you just know that it's been hard for him to just have one leg, because he is very clumsy, and he causes trouble because of that. And when he sees her just standing in one leg, he's like, oh, she's like me, and that's what makes him approach her. And once he realizes that she does have two legs, he kind of gets disappointed, but she still likes him, you know? And he still likes her, even though she has two legs.
And it's perfect. She can teach him how to be graceful on one leg.
Yeah.
It's perfect. Oh my God. It's adorable. I ship I it too. That's all I was thinking when I was watching this. I ship it. I also thought of Gina. Yeah. I was like, Gina would love this because she's a Libra yes. and she's romantic.
Absolutely. Like, I was really amazed at how fast I fell in love with the exactly. teen soldier and how fast
my
I
point
fell
exactly.
in love. And how, yeah, exactly. Like, you know, Tams. And just how fast I fell in love with their relationship. Like, just that moment of him seeing her in one leg. Like, oh, that just pulled my heartstrings. I was a goner since then. Aww. And just to see him just battle and fighting his way for her, basically, because he cares about her and he doesn't want her to be at the mercy of this creepy jack-in-the-box. I just find that so brave and so cute, and I love the tin soldier. He's a hero.
I stand the tin soldier from Fantasia 2000.
Yeah, and the music is really awesome. Like, it was said in the beginning they didn't have the right music, and okay, it paid off to wait, because
yeah,
mm-hmm. I can imagine the show with another music. Yeah, Tami, you want to say
your thoughts?
Yes,
my thoughts. Well, like I said, I did fall in love with the love story. Like, I thought this was one of my favorites. Oh, I like them all, but like. When they got that little romance at the end, I was like, it just made me all warm inside, and I just really loved it. I was like, this is sweet, and it's wonderful, and I will rewatch this over again. And actually, as I was watching it, I remembered, like, I read the story as a kid. Like, I didn't remember that at first. And, like, right when he was dropping into the ocean, I was like, he's going to be eaten by a fish, isn't he? And then he got eaten by the fish, and I'm like, I know this story. And I don't know, like, it just, I don't know what I also thought about, like, the Book of Jonah in the Bible, when he got eaten by the fish. It's a Hans Christian Andersen tale, right? I think he was influenced by religion a lot. So, like, I don't know. When he got swallowed by the fish, I immediately thought of that story. And thank you, Catholic school. But yeah, I enjoyed it. I think the ballerina is beautiful. Whenever she's dancing, it made me want to, like, dance. And I was like, I'm going to do a little twirl in my room, just really quickly. But yeah.
Did you?
Exactly. But can we also talk about how the tin soldier straight up murders the jack in the box, like, straight up, like, threw him into the fire. Like, did anyone else think that was kind of brutal?
A lot of, like, straight up murder in Fantasia.
Yeah, there's some murders in Fantasia. Next one is coming up, and I'm like wow, they're not.
Yeah, I thought it was brutal as well. Sorry.
Are they?
Tami, we lost you for a little bit. Can you repeat what you just said?
I was gonna, like, from the furnace part?
Yeah.
When I saw the furnace in the beginning, I thought to myself, they're not really gonna throw him in there, are they? And they did. And I'm like, you know what? Good for you, Disney. Like, we need more brutality in animation. Like, I approve of this.
We need more brutality in animation. That will be the description for this episode, I guess.
I'm down.
Brutality.
Yes.
I'm down. And I also liked how, like, the ballerina wasn't super passive. You know how it's like,
oh, she's awesome.
Yeah. Back then, like, you know, it's the hero story, the damsel in distress, and yeah, she's not the strongest, but, like, physically, but, like, she stands up to the jack in the box as best as she can, and she's like, no, I'm not dealing with your shit. Goodbye. Bye. And she tries her best to withstand him until the tin soldier can come, and they, like, work together to be able to, like, be together, and it's awesome, and I love it.
Oh, yeah. I love it so much. Mm-hmm. What I was gonna say, I just forgot.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah, that the fact that he throws him in the fire, like, I think it's because the animators just had more liberty, and they, you know, Fantasia, it's really its own thing. It's not even, I don't know, it exists in a completely different, like, alternate universe of Disney movies. And I think that's why they had more freedom and they felt more free to actually, you know, go through things like, you know, burning the jack in a box to death. And I just love the short, because it's just a sweet, quick, romantic story. And you just feel for for the characters as well. Like I just said with Rhapsody in Blue, like I love how with no dialogue at all, you can just understand their struggles and get on board with them and want to see them succeed. And yeah, I had something else that I wanted to say, but I blanked out. So do you have anything else you want to say, Andy?
It's just, it has everything. It has action, it has romance, it has like the defeat of a villain. It has different styles of animation also. The fish, when the fish that swallows him, the teen soldier, it's really 90s Disney, 2D Disney.
Yeah.
And that's cute. No, I like it. It's sweet.
I love it. Oh, yeah, I remember what I was going to say, that the Jack in the Box kind of reminds me of Lord Farquaad.
Yes.
Like, I'm pretty sure Jeffrey Katzenberg, like, took the design of,
oh my God. That's
of
so
the Jack
funny.
In the Box, like, and was like, this would work for my movie. Jeffrey Katzenberg. The next one is The Carnival of the Animals and Finale by Camille Saint-Saëns. Oh, this multilingual names. Oh my God. So this is the shortest. Yeah, I love the diversity. This is the shortest short out of all of them. You know, I think the longest is Rhapsody in Blue with 12 minutes, and The Carnival of the Animals is the shortest with 3 minutes. And there's actually like an explanation. Because it was all done by one person.
No way!
Eric Goldberg. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's short. Because he did it all by himself.
Wow, that's incredible.
Like, I just applaud him for getting through 3 minutes. Like, wow, that's amazing.
Oh my God, I was dying because I had to do a 15-second animation with a model I already had.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
So, Carnival of the Animals is a story about a wacky flamingo that is a master of the yo-yo, and he just wants to play his yo-yo, but a flock of 6 other flamingos are, you know, annoyed by him, and they keep trying to put him down, but he's just oblivious and keeps dodging them. And it's a really fun short. It's just basically an exercise on just seeing all this, this wacky flamingo just doing his yo-yoing. And I don't know how he came up with the idea. I think originally it was supposed to be ostriches, yep. But I guess I changed it just as to not be too close to the original Fantasia, because the original already had a segment with ostriches.
Yeah.
So they changed it to flamingos, and I just think it's really, really fun short to watch. The thing with the yo-yo is so funny, and I love how in the IMDb trivia page it says that those are real yo-yo moves he is making, and like a professional yo-yo player could watch it and be like, oh yeah, that's accurate. Like, you know how guitarists watch Coco and they're like, oh yeah, that's real guitar playing. You know, yo-yo players can watch this and be like, yeah, that's true.
Awesome.
The yo-yo masters of the world.
Yeah, I love how the he has a name. I think they named him our hero.
Our hero.
Subtle. But I love how he's a different shade of pink.
Mm-hmm.
And the snotty 6, as they are called, at least that's what IMDb says.
They are snotty.
I love that.
They are snotty. They are different. They are all the same shade of pink. And I just love how the hero one is just like so clever and starts pranking them basically, and using his yo-yo for like very cleverly, I guess. And I love the end of it, that they the Snotty 6 thought they were so clever and so awesome by getting rid of his yo-yo, but they didn't realize that he had like 6 more. He's like Ariel, like, you know, did you want a yo-yo? I have 20.
Oh,
I love this short. I think it's so fun. How about you? What do you think?
Tammy?
One thing that really stood, like, I love it too. It's really fun. It's lighthearted. It's great. And what I love about it is how simple the backgrounds are. And I think that's due to the fact there's so much going on in the foreground with the flamingos and how much they move. Like, you don't need like a complicated or very detailed background to make beautiful work. Like, I think the background for this was just like a solid color, a solid ombre color of different colors. And I still find it super beautiful that they were able to, that they, Eric Goldberg, just him, was able to put so much beauty and in the limited color palette.
Yeah, also and the limited design. Marks.
Yeah, and also like I think what's beautiful about this is the simplicity in everything that's designed. Like it doesn't even look like there's an outline in the on the characters, and it's just like they're solid color, and even like their joints are disconnected. Like it's a very simple design and art, which makes sense if he did it all by himself. You know, he didn't want he wouldn't want to animate anything complicated for 3 whole minutes, but I just love how he made the simplicity work for him, and it's very beautiful.
I think it's watercolors. That's what I read.
That's gorgeous. That's like, pretty.
That's why it looks so unique. And like, that's also what I wanted to say, that it's a very unique sort of style of animation, and it really looks like it's something. And I think it's partly because of the technique that is basically watercolors.
And it works perfectly with flamingos, because like you can see in like the film, because they're like always in the water. Like, it's just a nice homage to that.
Yeah. What do you think, Andy?
I was going to this story, it's a lot shorter and it's a lot sillier than the rest of the shorts. And I don't know if people had a complaint with it or something, but I think it's a nice break from everything. Like, you have this little piece that it's really sweet, and it's little. It's like, I don't know, like a little dessert you have, you continue with, and then you have the main courses. It's cute. And I was watching it, I was watching it now, and I just kept laughing. I'm sorry if that went through the audio.
I think I would have put this like earlier on. I think it feels kind of weird to have a very long short like Rhapsody in Blue and then have a very short one that, you know, I'm watching it on YouTube right now because it's the quickest thing I have at hand, and the YouTube video is like 1 minute and 50 seconds, and I don't know if it's sped up or something, because I read on IMDb that it was 3 minutes, but still, like, if it's 2 minutes or 3 minutes, it's still very short, and I think I would have placed this earlier, and that's the only thing that I would change about it, because other than that, I think it's a little work of genius, like, very simplistic, but very clever and funny, and very well executed, and also, I love that it's presented by James Earl Jones.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh, Mufasa. I screamed when he came on.
Yeah, I love, you know me, I love Lion King.
We were like, Darth Vader!
Mufasa! I love that there's also a little Mufasa statue behind him when he appears, and he just has the greatest voice.
The greatest voice.
I'm so glad they got him for this. And I love how they got him to introduce the animal section, segment.
I like it that he starts talking and he's like, oh, this short answers the age-old question. What is the relation between humanity and nature? And I was like, oh wait, no, it's about what happens when you give a jojo to a flamingo.
Everyone wondered that as a kid.
Didn't you?
Didn't you?
Well, lucky us, we have Fantasia 2000 for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, very near my hometown, there's this place where you can actually see flamingos very often.
Yeah.
And now, whenever I go and see them, I'm gonna be thinking about how they should be playing with a yo-yo.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That place is amazing.
Okay. Do you want to move on to the next one? The next one is a fantastic one. The next one is called The Sorcerer's Apprentice. It was originally composed by Paul Dukas, and you will know this short because it was in the original Fantasia, and as I read originally, they wanted to have multiple segments from the original Fantasia in this one, just to kind of make that, you know, the convergence of the past and the present, I think, more clear. But in the end, I don't know why, but they decided to cut the other segments and just stick with The Sorcerer's Apprentice, which I think it was a good decision, I think. Especially watching this back-to-back, I don't think I would have enjoyed Fantasia 2000 as much if I had seen the same shorts twice. I really like how Fantasia can be, you know, its own thing, and but I also love the just having a little bit of the last one, and I do hope that if they make one in the future, they will save one of the old of the Fantasia 2000 one.
Let's make a poll, our poll later, which one of these shorts you think will be in the next Fantasia.
That's a good poll.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, let's do that. But, okay, so I'm just gonna come right out and say, I think The Sorcerer's Apprentice is my favorite short from the original Fantasia. Just because I'm very emotionally attached to The Sorcerer's Apprentice Mickey.
Yeah.
He's my favorite version of Mickey, and I just have a lot of memories of him at the parks. And whenever I see him, I just get, like, all giddy inside and just very excited and happy, and I feel like a kid again when I watch him. So that's why I just have the softest spot for Sorcerer's Apprentice Mickey, so that's why I cannot be biased talking about Sorcerer's Apprentice. But, you know, there's a reason why they chose this short to come back, because it's really iconic. It's classic Disney, it's classic Mickey Mouse, it has Gen Z in it. The music, and it's a very high influence on Fantasmic, the show at Disneyland and Disney World.
That's Epic just the best
thing. It's the best thing that you can watch at the park. Andy and I watched it twice when we went there last year, and we were in tears basically by the end of it both times, because it's just beautiful. Sorcerer's Apprentice Mickey just has a big role in it. And the music also has a big role in it. It all comes down to that it's just a very iconic piece of Disney history. And I just love every second of this short. And I don't think there's anything wrong with it at all. Especially, like, even if Mickey does really murder a broom, he does feel bad about it. And the broom does come back times 2000.
times 2000! Yeah, how many brooms were there? Like, let's... Okay, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to say.
2000.
Okay, what were you going to say?
No, it's just that, Sorcerer Mickey has a really, really great influence in the history of animation, the history of Mickey, the history of Disney, and the history of the parks. And I actually have a friend that recognizes Sorcerer Mickey as Fantasmic Mickey. I was like, it's from Sorcerer's Apprentice, please.
You uncultured swine.
But yeah, it just comes to show that it's one of the most important pieces from Disney. Yeah. So, okay, if there has to be a short that was also into the Fantasia 2000, it will be Sorcerer's Apprentice. And what can we say about this?
It's just so iconic. I mean, the hat is literally on Walt Disney Animation Studios building.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Like, you just that just right there tells you how iconic it is. It really took a life on its own. Like, even if it was part of the original Fantasia, I think it just, this one soared way higher than the others. And I think even the Disney Channel sometimes showed it on its own, you know. Not showing Fantasia, just this short. And it's just, and like, I cannot blame them, and I can totally understand that it's just a fantastic little story, and you have Mickey Mouse in it, you cannot go wrong. The design of his wardrobe in this short is like really fantastic as well, like the color of the red and the blue, it just makes a nice contrast, and it's the stars in the hat, and Mm-hmm. That scene when he's dreaming and he's like controlling the water. It's so beautiful. The fantastic part, basically.
No, I actually really like the way they used to animate clothes and hair back in the golden era when the original Fantasia was made. So yeah, the robe from Mickey, I just want to squish it. I want to use it.
Yeah, me too.
Tami?
My thoughts about the film? The short?
It is kind of a film, yeah. The short film.
But yeah, I loved it. It was amazing. Like you said, it's iconic in Disney history, and it's very important. It's a very important short to watch to understand where Disney has come from and what has influenced it. And can I just say, when Mickey was woken up by the water, like, overflowing because of the room, and he realized he, like, messed up. Like, all I could think about was, like, I had the same exact experience, but, like, like literally, though. Like, I was boiling a chicken, and, like, I was boiling chicken, and I decided to take a nap. Like, he decided to, and I got woken up by my fire alarm.
Blaring. Timmy!
And all I could think was, like, this is the exact same thing. Like, for real, I was Mickey in that moment.
A bunch of boiled chickens were going to show up at your kitchen in March.
That pot was half full. Imagine how long it had to be boiling for all the water to have evaporated.
Oh my god, Tami.
You didn't take a nap, you went to sleep.
Yeah, basically.
I did.
Oh, that's just me with the beans. I always burn the beans.
Oh my god.
Yeah. I'm a basic Mexican.
This is turning into a cooking podcast. Don't boil the chicken too long. Don't burn the beans.
Yeah, and another thing that I love about this short, it's not like necessarily about the short, but one of my favorite Disneyland shows, is Mickey's Magical Map.
Oh yeah. Yes! Can we talk about Mickey's Magical Map?
And it like basically starts off with Mickey as in his apprentice robes. Like I forget if he like finds the hat or he finds this magical brush that like
the magic.
Yeah, it's a brush. Do you remember the magical brush that like helps him go through the map, and he visits different worlds from Disney, from animated films, and he goes to Lilo and Stitch, Mulan, Tangled, Princess and the Frog. I think she ends it, and it's freaking amazing. Like, I took my friend to Disneyland, and one of her favorite Disney princesses is Tiana, and I knew that, and I was like, she didn't know about the show, and I was like, we gotta watch Mickey's Magical Map, and I was waiting for her to see Tiana at the end, and when she came in, she freaking lost it, and I was
amazing. I just love the combination of Tiana, and you have Rapunzel, Mulan, and Pocahontas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's just like, wow, all my dreams are coming true.
So yeah, that's my favorite show at Disneyland.
Yeah, and Jen say that. Appears in that show as well.
He does, yeah. It's really wonderful. I watch it at least every year, or whenever I can get to Disneyland.
Yeah, I love that. We love that show too. Like, we were so excited. Like if you had seen Andy and I watching that show, like I think we were really annoying to other people. Well, we were having the time of our lives. We were singing. We were screaming for the characters whenever, like when Rapunzel and Tiana and Mulan appeared in the same
Pocahontas.
Like, oh yeah, Pocahontas appeared in the same like scene singing their own songs. We lost it.
It was beyond amazing.
I loved it.
Because Rapunzel's my favorite princess, and then like Pocahontas, and then Mulan, like princesses that don't get as much recognition or representation in the parks, they were there. Like, I just loved that show. Yeah. Go ahead.
Can I also say how I just remembered this, but like it was one of the times I was at Disneyland and I was trying to catch the show and we were late, and it was like, I don't know if it was the last show, but I wanted to see it then, because then you would have to wait like an hour, I think. I literally sprinted to the set. I was telling my family to catch up with me. I was like, we gotta run so we can catch it. I was like literally sprinting, and I actually ran into a woman and made her drop her phone, and like I didn't like help her. I was jogging, and I was like, I'm sorry, ma'am, but I have to go. And I sprinted to the set, and I looked back at my family's nowhere to be seen. And I'm like, screw it, I'm save them seats.
Oh my god.
They made it eventually, but I remember literally running to catch that show because I love it so much.
Running in Disneyland, I can relate.
Yeah, we can relate.
Running in Disneyland at 1 a.m. to catch the last day, yeah. The last Cars Land.
Yeah, because we had fast passes. Just side story, we had fast passes that day, but when we went to... We went at the time of the
fast attraction pass, broke.
But it was broken down, and they were like, oh, you can come back later. Like, you can use that you can use that fast pass as at any other time of the day. When the ride breaks down during your fast pass, it just becomes like
a multi fast pass for every hour, every attraction.
Any attraction, mm-hmm. any hour, you can mm-hmm. use it in anywhere you want to. But we really wanted to get to Cars Land because we hadn't gotten the chance.
Yeah.
Because it was just there's just so much to do, especially if like me, it's your first time there and you just want to see everything.
Mm-hmm.
So this was after New Year, like it was already past midnight.
Yeah,
we were like, do you want to go to? Do you want to cross over to California Adventures and see if we can catch cars because we still have the fast pass? And we were like wondering if it was gonna work because it was past midnight and maybe the app just resets past midnight, and we were like, I don't know if it's gonna work. And then we got there and the app just, it was yeah. taking the longest time to open, and the cast member there was just like, just go
through the fast pass lane. It was
whatever,
like
just go. And we didn't even use the fast pass in the end, and we got there and we rode Cars at like 12:30 like midnight.
And then we sprinted. What was
the first thing that we did on 2018?
We're yes. that iconic Cars.
Yeah. It's a very good ride.
It's an amazing ride. And then we sprinted to the wheel, to Mickey's Fun Wheel.
We also ran to that because it was closing in like 3 minutes, and we were like, we can still catch it, and we ran through California Adventures. Oh, it was the best night.
Oh, I like this detour to the parks. Thank you, Tami.
Yeah. Can I also say one more thing about the short?
Yes.
Okay, so what I really liked about this film, which was different from Fantasia, was how different the art style was for each short. I thought it yeah. gave a lot of variety, it gave a lot of life, and it gave each short its own identity. And I really enjoyed that. And I think the style for Sorcerer's Apprentice, like, I mean, it was made during Walt Disney's time, and I just think of it as classic Disney.
Yeah.
And I love how they included it here, because it's what makes Fantasia 2000 a Disney film. And I think it was very important for them to include it, and I think it's great. Yeah, I think having that classic Disney style was very important. I'm glad that they made that decision.
The next one?
Okay, the next one. Just, we love Sorcerer's Apprentice, and that's all you need to know about that.
It's just two shorts, and we're done?
Yeah, two more shorts.
Yep.
The next one is Pomp and Circumstance, Marches 1, 2, 3, and 4 by Edward Elgar.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a short based on the tale of Noah's Ark from the Bible, but reimagined with Donald Duck.
Amazing. Everything should be reimagined with Donald Duck.
Everything. Every single Bible passage should be reimagined with Donald Duck.
Can I go to Disney and just throw money at them until they do that? Please.
Yeah. That's a brilliant idea, like Donald's Biblical Adventures. Like, I can totally see that on a Saturday morning.
Donald's Biblical Adventures!
Yeah. Anyway, so basically Donald takes the role of Noah's, not apprentice, but
assistant.
Like, helper assistant. Mm-hmm. He's not Noah, he just gets the task of uniting the animals to get in the ark.
Mm-hmm.
And basically the story is that he does that, but during that time he loses Daisy, and then the flood comes and he doesn't think that Daisy made it to the boat, to the ark, and he just keeps the rest of the journey like mourning Daisy.
Aww.
What he doesn't know is that Daisy did make it to the ark, and Daisy also thinks that Donald didn't make it because she didn't see him getting to, like, jumping in. So basically they both think the other's dead, and it's just very sad to see them like really mourning the other. Like, this is like kind of dark and very, very sad. Like, I cannot, like, the pain of losing your significant other, I don't know what that must feel like, but it should be like the most horrible thing.
Mm-hmm.
And once they make it to, once the flood goes away and they make it to dry land, they reunite. They both get off the ark and Daisy loses this necklace that Donald gave her. So she goes back to look for it and Donald finds it. And there's the beautiful shot of them like reaching at the same time for it. And they look at each other and it's like they get all teary-eyed and they hug each other because they reunited and they're like, oh, you're not dead. And it's a very beautiful short. Yeah. I love it. I completely agree. Like, everything should be reimagined with Donald Duck. He's the best.
He is my second favorite of the Mickey gang.
I don't know who's my favorite. I think my favorite, of course, is Mickey.
Yeah, me too.
But I have the softest spot for Goofy, but I also love Donald. And I love Donald whenever he's with Daisy, because I think Donald is at his best. Is at his best when he's with Daisy.
Yes, they are.
I just love it. And I just really love whoever came up with the idea of putting Donald Duck on a bicycle. Sorry. I just find it like completely genius.
Yeah. Can I just say my favorite part in this whole short was when he was reuniting the animals and then he just he sees two dogs there and he's like, oh, okay. And then, what?
Oh, the dogs.
That, like, the real dogs. They were real dogs. And he was like, okay.
I love it.
But he just.
Yeah.
It's really amazing. Well, I should continue then.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think out of all the shorts, this is the most traditional Disney one, I guess. Because, I don't know, it has the Disney characters and the style is Disney-ish, but also it's really amazing to see these characters, Donald and Daisy, with this kind of quality, because you usually see like shorts for made up for TV or for direct to video, and the lighting and the scenery is in the background and everything is just so detailed, and I love to see Donald in there. Actually, I think the lighting in the last scene from the short is amazing. I just stared at it a lot. And yeah, I really like it. It's also really funny. That's also what makes it very Disney-ish because of the humor. And Tami?
Yeah. I really liked it as well as you guys did. And I don't know, like, I know we keep making this joke about how this is Fantasia times 2000, but what I really liked is how they, like, you know, like, that's what they've been doing this whole time. They take something that's already good and they add something extra to it to just make it even better. They took the Noah's story, but they didn't just do Noah's story. They added something. They added the loss of a loved one with Daisy and Donald, and I think that works perfectly because I never saw the romance or love aspect in the Noah's Ark story with the animals of every, like, male and female on board. I just saw it as a way for population to reproduce, but like when I see them, like the scene where Donald is looking at all the animals being together and Daisy is looking at all the animals being together and then they remember their lost loved ones, I was like, that's there, that you can totally see that aspect in the original story, and they capitalized that on that and emphasized that and made it the main part of their interpretation of the story. And I love it. Like, that's what they've been doing. They've been adding their own spin to all these, or to this original, to this music, and they're making it their own, and it's wonderful. There's just so many layers and complexities to these shorts, and it's wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with you.
Everything you just said.
Everything, just retweet, copy and paste. I really love the joke they make with the unicorn and I don't know what the other mythical creatures that they don't make it to the ark, and that's why you don't find unicorns anymore. I just found that hilarious. Like, no, I busted out laughing when I saw that.
It's clever.
Yeah, I also love the little bit when they're getting off the ark and Donald sees the two bunnies, and then they are followed by a bunch of tiny, like, baby bunnies, and you're like, oh yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think it's
as you said, it's just a beautiful reimagining of the story, and I agree with you, Tams, how they were clever enough to take a part of the story that's not really, I guess it's not the central part of the story when you tell it. It was basically just for the animals to reproduce and continue its existence on Earth. But yeah, you just feel like when Donald loses Daisy and Daisy loses Donald, and they're surrounded basically by couples, and you just realize,
I mean, hashtag my life, like,
me too. You just feel for them, and you just like feel that sense of loneliness, of loss, of, you know, it's not just that you don't have that partner to reproduce and continue the species, but you just lost your loved loved one, and it's just really tragic. And you spend the short just feeling so anxious and so worried and so sad, because like you as the audience know that both of them are alive, and you just want to yell it at them, like, don't worry, Donald, Daisy's alive, she's right there. But and it just really pays off in the end when they find each other. And I just think it's a really fun little short. It's very emotional, like you wouldn't expect a short with Donald Duck to be this emotional.
I know, right?
But it is. They managed to make that happen, and I just love the ideas that they have for it, and the way they executed them. It's a really clever little short. I love it so much. This is another one that I could watch over and over again. And also, like, I think the most like, as Andi said, all the shorts are very different in style, but I think one constant in every short is how beautiful the lighting is. Every short has its own style of lighting, but each of them like reproduces light in a beautiful way, and it's it's one outstanding part of each short, the lights. And I just find that really, really pretty, and it just makes you want to look at it even more. Like, you just keep rewatching it because it's just a pleasant thing to watch. You know, the light is actually like delightful, if I should say it, if I should put it that way. But just watch it and just want to never stop watching. It's really a treat to the eyes. Andi?
No, I think I'm totally good.
You're good? Yeah. Okay, so we are good to continue to the last one?
Yes! Please do that!
So good.
This gave me chills. Called Firebird Suit 1919 by Igor Stravinsky, and it's about the spring sprite awoken by an elk, and she's beautiful. The spring sprite unknowingly wakes up the firebird, and the firebird is like this giant monster. It basically comes out of a volcano, and I think it's inspired by the eruption of a real life volcano. And basically this firebird completely burns everything in its path, and it leaves the spring sprite just completely, like, I love how they show her like so small, so tiny, just because she has like literally nothing left because the firebird completely burned it to the ground. And eventually, like, the elk helps her to regain her courage and her will to exist, basically. And with the help of the elk, she manages to bring nature and spring back to the world, despite the fire, despite the burn, despite the destruction. And I just found it absolutely beautiful. So do you guys want to start first?
Tami?
Yeah. Well, I just think this is a beautifully animated film. Like, the way the spring sprite moves around the screen is just absolutely wonderful, and I can't even begin to think how they would even like animate that. It's just like, it seems like she's always moving, like she has ripples all around her, and she's just so flowy and just looks so, I don't know, soft and graceful, and it's mm-hmm. it's wonderful animation. I also love that one scene where she's growing the flower, or like not even growing, like creating it. Like it looks like she weaves the flower to begin with, mm-hmm. and then yeah. she completely changes her mind and then like disintegrates it and then reforms it within
yeah.
to make it a bigger, beautiful, and even grander flower. And I think that is just a gorgeous piece of animation. But what really stood out to me was how it's actually super relevant to today. With I'm not super into yeah. politics, but like how our crisis with the environment and how we all need to be better with our pollution, our waste, and just being more mindful of the earth we live in. And I think that this is such a good film to watch, a good short to watch, because it can show you that there is hope even in our darkest days, like even in general, not just in the environment, but like focusing on the environment, yeah. like it can show you that there is something to fight for and that there is something that we can stand up for, and we can make better, and we can still have a rebirth even if it seems like all hope is lost. And I think it's just a wonderful message, and it's just a great short.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say, that I think the most obvious message is like to take care of the environment and mm-hmm. and all of that, but I do think that deep down it's not just about that. I think just the allegory of rebirth and destruction mm-hmm. and being reborn from the ashes, I think yeah. it applies to every single aspect of your life,
yeah.
like even like in personal matters, but also like as you said, not getting to politics, but everything that happens yeah. around the world, that you can make a case that right now we are living in a time where it does feel like the firebird just came out of a volcano and it's ruining everything in its path.
Yeah.
But just to have this character like the Spring Sprite to make you realize that there's always hope, and there's always yeah. gonna be good people, and there's always gonna be like values, and
yes.
in the end, even if things go to hell basically, and even if things seem really wrong and really out of balance and it just feels like everything's lost,
yeah,
it's not actually, and there's always gonna be like the tiniest glimpse of
hope yeah,
that you just need to water it and care for it and make it grow, and eventually it's gonna be okay again. Eventually yeah, it's gonna,
I totally agree with
everything
you.
Is gonna be reborn, and
yes,
things will go back to being good again.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just the cyclical nature of life, I guess, just to have the good part of things, and then eventually something is going to happen, something needs to happen, you know, life is not static.
Mm-hmm.
And for every good thing, something bad needs to happen to balance things, and it's just how it is.
Yeah,
that's how it is. For every good thing there's a bad thing, and for every bad thing there's a good thing, and that's how we move forward.
I keep saying yeah, but I'm sorry, because this is something I literally learned in the past year, and I'm like, yes, Gina, preach.
Yeah.
I've learned to love my failures. Like I don't like it's because I failed a lot, and it's just I feel like I've learned my most valuable lessons from what I failed at. And now whenever as soon as I learn to love my failures and face those obstacles, like whenever I face something challenging, I go at it full force with positivity and just I'm the mindset that I'm going to overcome it, because even though I failed, that's okay, because I know I can learn from it. And I think that's an important message to take away from this short film for anyone who listens. Like it's just an important life lesson.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially because the firebird is absolutely, like, scary. Like, it's so, like, it's giant, and it doesn't seem like you can stop it. Like, you can stop it. Like, it just...
It might overtake you, but you can...
It overtake, yeah, completely. It just goes away because it wants to go away. Because
you don't like, have to stop it. You just have to get through.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there are things in life that are just as scary as that bird. Like... The bird is not even on that much, but the shots that it gets, they're so powerful, they're so, like, dominant. Like, I can compare it to Chernabog in the original Fantasia. you know, Chernobog was, you know, Satan, but, you know, the Firebird is just the embodiment of, I guess, evil as well, and everything that can go wrong. Yeah. And that's what makes it so scary as well.
Yeah.
Andi, you have been very quiet. What do you want to say?
Because you were making such great arguments. yeah, basically everything you said, but about the short in particular, in relation of the film and in relation of the company. For me, this is Fantasia 2000. For me, this is the big short from this movie. This is the short that I remember the most. It's my favorite. It used to be my favorite short. It still has a very, very special place in my heart. But after doing this and after talking about it, I honestly don't know which one is my favorite short. But it will always have a really, really special place in my heart. And it was, like I said in the Pocahontas episode, this is one of the other influences that influenced me. Ugh. This was one of the media that influenced me to, I don't know, really care about nature and the environment when I was a kid, and I'm still like that today. But that started since I watched this, and this made me, I don't know, feel all kinds of things, especially about nature and about caring about it and about how important it is and about how beautiful it is, and that, I don't know, it just a force that is amazing, the Spring Sprite. I've always loved her. I always treated her like a Disney character that I can put with the others as one of my favorites. And the animation is really amazing. And I just love the imagery of everything, of when everything is dark and it's doomed, and then she just starts making it all green and making it all beautiful. It's just really, really uplifting. And it's really, really the perfect piece to end the movie with.
Yeah.
It just leaves you with so much hope. And
yeah,
I really love it. Yeah.
I think the word I would use to describe this short is powerful, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's powerful in every single aspect. It has powerful music, powerful animation, powerful story, and a powerful message. So it's just absolutely stunning. It's outstanding.
Mm-hmm.
And like, we're just watching it now as we are talking about it. And I just noticed how the thing that starts making things grow again are her tears.
Aww.
And like that, I love that right there is a little symbol, like, you know, yes, like crying about things that have gone wrong is okay, and that is the first step into getting better and you know, finding a new life.
The tear heals,
and yeah, the tear heals.
It's nice. Official. Firebird Speed is my favorite short.
Spoilers. That comes next. Okay, so just to wrap up our thoughts on this, I think the other shorts are very fun and they're powerful on their own, but this one is just, it's one that doesn't have as many jokes and doesn't have, like, it's not as quick-witted, you know, as Rhapsody in Blue or the Carnival of Animals, but it's special and it's powerful in its own way. It's very different from the others, and as you said, I think it's the perfect thing to end the movie with, like, I cannot imagine anything more powerful than this.
Mm-hmm.
So, you guys have any more closing thoughts on this particular short?
Nope.
Yeah, I think you should notice that when you watch the logo for the podcast, you know, the drawing. Yeah. I'm dressed as a spring sprite.
Yeah.
Just because she's the best. She's so beautiful, and she's really inspiring. And I love her.
What an honor.
I want to be her. Okay, so just to wrap things up, generally about Fantasia, I think it, as I said in the beginning and as I said earlier, I think it's a very well-deserving sequel to Fantasia. I think Walt Disney would have been proud of it, and that's the biggest compliment I can give it.
Yeah.
It does, because it was supervised by Roy Disney himself, like the nephew of Walt. It does continue what Walt envisioned when he first came up with the idea for Fantasia, and that it continues what Walt wanted it to be. And I just find it really beautiful to not let Walt's legacy die and continue it in these ways that are, you know, so deserving. And they're very, you know, it's a, you know, Fantasia deserved a sequel like this. Like, mm-hmm. Fantasia is one of those movies that it was meant to have sequels. It was meant to be a huge project that, for, you know, many reasons, was not. But, you know, to have these movies, you know, as I'm expecting us to have, you know, in a couple more years, to have another Fantasia, I think it would just fit perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it would just keep going and going. And it Fantasia will never stop.
Yeah.
Growing, I think. Like, just Disneyland. Like Disneyland. Yeah, exactly. It will never be finished, because there will always be a new form of animation. There will always be new music. There will always be new stories. There will always be new animators with new ideas, with new things that they will turn into art. And that's why Fantasia will always be there, I think. I hope so.
Mm-hmm. Imagine the next Fantasia with CGI animation and stop motion and all those kinds of stuff. Maybe they figure out rotoscoping and not make it scary when that comes out.
I'm really excited. Like, I'm really, really excited. I hope there is a Fantasia. There's another Fantasia in my lifetime.
It's
just really refreshing to talk about a masterpiece on this podcast. Yeah, don't you think?
This is like the best one, like the
objectively best.
Objectively best one, because, you know, Lion King will always be the Lion King 2 will always be the best sequel in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
But this one, just, I think, it's just such a refreshing thing, like, to not be like, okay, so
how does it hold up?
What can we say from it?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I wasn't even thinking about those questions, because I was just thinking about this movie as its own thing, and what it means to be a sequel to Fantasia. Okay, so what do you think, Tim?
I mean, I agree with everything you guys said. It's just absolutely wonderful. It's probably my favorite Disney sequel. Like, it would be blasphemy to say otherwise, any other Disney sequel. I don't know how much I can add as to what you said. You guys just said it perfectly, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the big question is, what's your favorite segment of the movie? And Tami, you go ahead, because you already spoiled that.
It's the Firebird Suite, and I only realized that after we started discussing it. And that's what I love about discussions, because you learn so much more about the media you're consuming. Of course, you have an initial appreciation, but once you really dive deep, you can really see the inner workings of that short. Like, I was able to discover the how they took Noah, that unknown element of Noah's Ark story, and then emphasize it in their own to make it original. And then how we discovered that the Firewood Suite is a message of hope and rebirth, and learning from your failures, and letting, and that you don't have to overcome your failure to still grow and to still be better. And I think that's really important. And the fact that I had to learn that in my own life is what makes that short my favorite, because it's so personal to me, and it's probably something I'm gonna watch over and over again. And anytime I feel like I'm in a dark place, I will watch that, because I know there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and I just love it.
Yeah, definitely. Oh my god, I'm gonna cry.
I'm going to cry too. Oh my god. I said before that Firebird was my favorite, but I didn't know now. I think I will say Firebird.
Mm.
It's Firebird, but I love them all. Can I say Fantasia 2000 is my favorite short?
There you go. Yeah, 2000? You can. It's fine.
No, but it is the Firebird Suite for everything you said, and because of nostalgic value, and just because of the artistry of it. Yeah.
Just make it three, because I think it's just, it can't be. I mean, I really do love all of them. Like, I cannot come up with something bad to say about any of them.
Yeah.
Because they're all special, they're all different, they're unique, and each of them has something that makes it stand out from the others. It just really depends on my mood. Like, I was talking to Andy earlier, and I was like,
you know, after, just right after we finished watching it, I was like, oh yeah, the Firebird suit is my favorite. But then looking back, I was like, okay, no, so Pints of Rome, I think, is my favorite, because mm-hmm. I just love the image of the whales and the clouds and the water. And then I was like, no, you know what? That the Donald Duck one is my favorite, because I just connect with it, because it's Donald. And just I could go on and on and never like really make up my mind. And you know, I think it depends on my mood. For now, I think I'm gonna say the Firebird suit, but the Pints of Rome, I think it's a very, very close second, because it really gave me chills. Like the animation, it just kept me on the edge of my seat and kept me gasping and made me just, I was in awe watching the Pints of Rome, and the way that the whales fly over the clouds. I just, it's something that children come up with, and to see it put so beautifully into film, I think it's just a fantastic experience, a fantastic thing to look at.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think there's any point of asking like how it holds up to original, because I think we all agree that it's a disturbing sequel. Like,
yeah.
It holds up to what the values that Fantasia wanted to bring out to the world. And that's the important thing. And I'm really, really glad that they pulled it off, even despite Katzenberg being against the project. I really appreciate every single person that worked in this and that realized the potential that a sequel to Fantasia had and what it must be. And they did just that, and I'm really thankful. And so I'm going to move on to ratings. Do you guys have your ratings ready?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tammy?
Fantasia is what every Disney sequel should be. Fantasia 2000 is what every Disney sequel should be, in every French. Sense of the word.
Sequel. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, improving and just building off from mm-hmm. the original and respecting the original and its values. Yeah, yes. Definitely. Andi?
I love this Fantasia sequel plus 2000.
Oh my gosh.
Of course.
Yeah. Okay.
What did you say?
Okay, I was going to say the fantastic thing.
Yes, but, do it. I was like, is she going to say it? Is she going
to
say it?
I was about to ask, would you do the fantastic thing?
I have another one.
Do it.
I do think Fantasia 2000 is fantastic. Yeah. Oh. I'll add this. I think the other rating I can give it is Walt will be proud.
And
that's the biggest thing that I can say to describe it. And
I just came up with a joke.
Oh my god.
Do it.
Oh my god. Go ahead.
Fantastic sequels and where to find them.
Oh my god. I'm gonna cut that out of the podcast. Just because we are really close to the premiere of Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them too.
I'm so excited.
Oh, me too.
Are you guys gonna watch it together?
Yeah, we're gonna watch it on the midnight.
I'm so jealous. I gotta find someone to watch it with. No. I can watch it on my own.
You should come to Mexico and we can go together. I was gonna say, oh yeah, just for the record, and just because I don't want it to, I don't want this episode was really fun, because it really allowed us to talk something good, because it was a very good movie. But I don't want to end the episode without our Star Wars reference. And I'm gonna say it, and I know Andi. All right.
But go on.
About the second one.
Okay, so Andi hates this joke, and I've made it like 3 times in her presence, and she always like that's a, she always is like, that's a rich Gina, stop. And I'm like, no, this is a good joke. And you know, we were watching Fantasia, the original one, and when the broom comes back, you know, Mickey destroys it, and then
He brutally murders the broom
with an axe, and then very The Shining. Here's Mickey.
I'm in my garage. Remember that, and I'm scared.
Oh my god! No, sorry. Okay, so the thing I was gonna
say. You're not a broom, so.
No, so you're fine. So the thing I was gonna say is that the broom comes back times 2000, and each of them is a replica of the first one, so they're basically all clones, and they're there to attack Mickey. So when we were watching it,
wonderful.
I would turn to Andi and I was like, oh, Attack of the Clones.
Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
You can't see me, but I'm facepalming.
I was so proud of myself at that moment. I felt like, oh, this is the Clone Wars, this is Attack of the Clones.
It's amazing. Okay,
but my fantastic sequels joke didn't
That's more of a reach. Of course. Yes,
well,
it is.
Let's call it a draw.
Okay.
Let's just finish okay. the episode.
Okay, so I think that wraps things up mm-hmm. for the episode. Okay, this was a very different from the others because it was for the first time it was not painful at all to watch this.
I know, it was wonderful.
Yeah, I just want to go and buy the Blu-ray right now because I think I'm missing it from my life.
Oh.
Also a little fun thing: we read that the DVD has a audio commentary. By Roy Disney and Mickey Mouse himself. So if you have the DVD, you should check that out. And Andy has a DVD.
But I don't have it here because...
she doesn't have it here. She has it at her hometown. And we're going to be there in December. So maybe we will watch it together with the commentary. Because I can't miss the Mickey Mouse audio commentary.
We can live react on Twitter.
We should. Yeah. Yes. We can do that. Okay, mm-hmm. So I think that's... all for Fantasia 2000. I'm so happy we got through this. I'm happy because it was just a really fun thing to talk about.
It really was.
It was refreshing for us.
I think the next movie we will review that will come, well, that will be part of the lineup of Disney movies will be Wreck-It Ralph.
No, Winnie Pooh.
Winnie Pooh counts as a sequel?
People well, we count when we were planning the podcast, we counted it as a sequel, so it's in the schedule, but I mean, we can talk about it, but I don't know, maybe we should watch it and then decide.
And then decide if it's a sequel? Okay, but, I just wanted to talk about that. I'm really excited for a
graph. Ralph Breaks the Internet comes out in like 3 weeks, and I'm really excited.
I know, same. I can't wait.
Like, it depending on how it does, I think we may be entering a new age of Disney sequels.
I'm scared, Martin.
Because we have Ralph and then Frozen right after, and if they do well, which they probably will, at least financially, I think maybe something will start from that. Maybe we'll get Zootopia 2, maybe, who knows? Maybe Big Hero 6 too, I don't know. I think it's very exciting. It's very exciting, like... whatever happens with Wreck-It Ralph 2, I mean, Ralph Breaks the Internet, it will
break there.
It will have consequences on the future of the studio, definitely. And that's going to be very interesting to watch. But we have a long way until we review Wreck-It Ralph 2. So for now, let's leave it at that. Next week, we are covering a sequel to a beloved Renaissance movie. The Little Mermaid 2.
So excited. That's my childhood I have so much to talk about this one.
I'm so excited. Yeah, me too. I think this one and The Lion King 2 are the ones that I grew up watching the most.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. I think it's just, you know, because we were girls and our age. Yeah.
Yeah.
Melody. It makes sense.
It does.
So yeah, I'm really excited for us to tackle that. I'm really excited to revisit it. I haven't seen it in a long time. I'm curious on how it's gonna hold up after so many years. So yeah, come back next week to listen to that. And until then, we'll see you. Thank you for listening. And remember, you can follow us on Twitter. @2divisionpod, and you can send us an email to 2division@gmail.com. You can send us your questions, you can send us your comments, you can send us your suggestions or anything you want to say to us about the podcast, about the sequels. You can send us your own opinions about the movies that we have reviewed. And yeah, so I think that's basically it for this episode. And thank you guys for listening. And come back next week. Thank you so much. We'll see you then.
Bye, guys.
Goodbye. Bye.